music of the Titanic, and you are going to hear beautifully genteel selections tonight. Everything that we played, we are playing tonight, would have been music on board. They had about a list of 352 pieces that they were ready to perform, and they were all given a different number. And one of the pieces that they were working on a lot were on some of the Joplin rags, so we're going to start with that.
Jacob Astor with his new wife, second wife, and she was pregnant, name was Gabriel. They were coming here to visit folks in Philadelphia, and quite an elegant man who enjoyed good cigars, sitting by the palm tree, listening to the quartet play. I was, well, we have here a photograph of the musicians who gathered from various places. However, the White Star Line did require that these people have experience as performers on the ships, because as Sandy mentioned, they had a book, they had an official book of tunes, and that when they started the play, they didn't say to each other, let's play the Maple Reef Rag, this is number 10, number 71, and they had to know exactly what number 71 was and how to play it. Now these musicians were actually considered to be quite heroes of the event, because on the fateful night of April 14th, just before midnight, from high up in the lookouts, where there were four lookouts on ship, they heard the distress call that there was something large, black, and looming in the distance. They telephoned this down to the captain, who said, thank you very much. And shortly after that, they hit something. And the musicians at that point were not quite sure what to do. However, it was recommended to them that they keep playing because they could comfort the people in a moment of distress. People started, you know, wondering what was happening. Some people weren't affected at all. Some people were starting to panic. The musicians were the ones who thought, well, we play music, it'll indicate, give a tenor to the evening of a calm, controlled situation. And the musicians were, as things got worse, and they progressed quite quickly, hit the iceberg before midnight, and it sank by 2:20. Actually, the last lifeboat was manned about a half hour before that. And the musicians were dismissed. They did not have to stay at their post. They were not actually considered members of the crew. They were actually, I don't quite know how the relationship was actually called. They were employees who had to do what they were told, certainly by the White Line, but they were not members of the crew. They decided on their own volition to keep playing and to restore the calm. They knew, I think, that they were not going to be able to be on the lifeboats. It was just understood. And they heroically decided to keep the calm, keep playing as long as possible. And they did up until about the last lifeboat was launched, when the ship began to plunge below the surface. And according to one report, these poor people were wiped off the ship by a wave. Quite a dramatic story. A few of the bodies were recovered, and there was a memorial to them in, I believe, in Southampton, where the ship took off. So, with that in mind, I think of one story, Sandy, about the cellist, who was unsure at this point whether he should bring his good cello on board. Now that means something to us as musicians, because sometimes our good instruments, we think, well, maybe suppose we're out on the deck having to play in a fog, you know, and things are starting to get wet and clammy, maybe we better not bring our good cello with us. He decided this was such a good job, top of the line for him as a young man, that he would indeed play his best cello. So I think all around they deserve quite a bit of credit. So we would like to play perhaps another piece of music that would have been popular, at a theme certainly that's known to us. I think this is from, was borrowed from a movie about, remember Troy Donahue years ago? It was a movie about the South Pacific, you know, and in those days two things, exotic, like rags were considered exotic, and music from, had some connotation of Egypt, very popular, you know. And so we're going to play for you a nocturne by the famous Russian composer Borodin, and I think you may recognize this theme, which has been set to words as well. This is the nocturne from one of his string quartets, number 2, I believe.
Thank you.
beautiful piece.
Now, we borrow from Kismet. I remember that Kismet was based on these things, and the song was called Stars My Beloved. It's very interesting, too, the debate, too, about what was played by the musicians as the final piece, which was used in the older movie, God to Thee, which is set to two different tunes, actually. So one of the mates that commanded one of the ships got off alive handling one of the lifeboats swore up and down that that was not the last piece they played. A piece called Autumn, which is also gone for. They can't quite figure out what Autumn was, but certainly Nearer Thy God to Thee is a great hymn. Was certainly
it's a better story.
Yes. Remember for big in the movie.
Well, one of the things that when you look over the list of music that we had on board, there was a lot of Gilbert and Sullivan. So we thought we'd do three selections from that.
Oh, Gilbert and Sullivan. Great team of musicians, you know, but they hated one another. Hated one another. One was well known for his church music, and he wanted to be very, very legitimate. The composer wanted to have a, to write opera and what have you, and it just didn't work for the poor fellow. And despite the fact that he hated working with the fellow who made up these corny lyrics about little buttercups and things, it was his bread and butter for many, many years, Gilbert Sullivan, yeah. And they did quite a bit of work together. And over the years, I think it's remained some of the catchier and more popular tunes. We're going to play Little Buttercup, which is from one of the operators, HMS Pinafore.
Thank you.
selection from Gilbert and Sullivan is going to be When I Was a Lad from before. But he loved violin and he loved piano, and he decided he was going to make his career in music after all. So he started playing in some of the orchestras, the cafe orchestras, and he played piano. And he said, nope, this isn't the place for me, I'm going to New York. So he moved to New York, and he was hired by what's called the Schubert Brothers, who were two brothers who ran theaters. And he was hired to compose for them. So he started off as a composer and continued for the rest of his life as a composer for theater music. And one of the things we're going to be playing now is his song called Lover, Come Back to Me. And you are going to hear, this is the most genteel, sweet, high caliber music. It's just so turn of the century. I hope you enjoy it as much as we do. We have about three of his different pieces that we're going to be playing. So this is Lover, Come Back to Me by Sigmund Romberg.
Thank you.
one of his songs we're going to be doing is called the Drinking Song. I should say that Mr. Romer got so into writing operettas, he wrote 70. Mm-hmm. 70 operettas, can you imagine? And so he was turning out more than two a year. And most of them were for the New York theaters. But highly popular composer. Lots and lots of his music was printed, not the whole opera, but just songs from it, like these. And you could buy them for ukulele or organ or piano. And one of the things which was really nice about the Titanic, they expected their guests to be conversant, fluent, really, in this type of musical genre. And the first class section had five grand pianos, and the second class had two uprights. So there was plenty of opportunity for you to bring your sheet music along and play. And when they unearthed the Titanic, there was a lot of sheet music in suitcases that people had brought. And so part of the reason we're playing this music is this was just so typical of what people would have heard and played and enjoyed at that time. So this is the Drinking Song by Sigmund Romberg. Scheduled evenings for dancing. There was there were a number of places where the musicians would be playing. One was called Café Parisien, and it was in this eating area that there was a dance floor with the potted palms and so forth. And typical of what you would be doing would be one of the tables, so it was chock full.
And a funny little thing, for some reason, I read at one place, dancing was discouraged in general. It must have been just sort of a formalized event.
It was a formalized event, exactly. In other words, if the musicians were playing for dinner, it was not a good idea to get up and move your feet while they were playing for you to eat. It had to be a formal event. Okay, so here we go with our tango.
Thank you.
every year, you know, we've been doing this Titanic Orchestra for about 10 years. And every year I still have fun doing more research about the different people and the boat and how it all happened and the music. I just find it fascinating. So I thought tonight I would share with you the menus for first class, second class, and third class on the day that the boat was sailing. So I'm going to read this out for you. I got a kick out of this. So first class, here we go. Hors d'oeuvres, you can get a variety of oysters, consommé Olga, and cream of barley soup. And then you can have, these are still the hors d'oeuvres, salmon with the cucumber sauce. Then the main meal, you can have filet mignon lily, sauté of chicken lyonnaise, vegetable marrow farci, lamb with mint sauce, roast duckling, applesauce, sirloin of beef, chateau potatoes, green peas, cream carrots, boiled rice, boiled new potatoes, punch romaine, roast squab and cress, cold asparagus vinaigrette, pot de foie gras, celery, Waldorf pudding, peaches in a chartreuse jelly, chocolate and vanilla eclairs. That is first class. Are you full yet? Second class. Consommé. Baked haddock, sharp sauce, curried chicken and rice, spring lamb with mint sauce, roast turkey, cranberry sauce, green peas, pureed turnips, boiled rice, boiled and roast potatoes, plum pudding, wine jelly, coconut sandwich, American ice cream, nuts assorted, fresh fruit, cheese, biscuits, and coffee. Pretty good still. Third class, now this I just couldn't believe. Oatmeal porridge and milk. Pea soup, codfish cake, smoked herrings, ling fish egg salad, cheese and pickles, jacket potatoes, which means baked potatoes, cold beef and pickles, fresh bread and butter, curried beef and rice, cabbage boiled potatoes, plum and apple jam, fresh bread and butter, cabin biscuits, fresh bread, Swedish bread, cerealine pudding, tea and coffee, oranges. So that's your third class.
Yeah, they're the only ones who won't have scurvy, right?
Anyway, I got such a kick out of the difference between the first, second, and third class. And I guess one of the things that was kind of nice about the musicians.
That was only breakfast, right?
The musicians got to play in all classes. There were eight musicians and hardly ever played together. You were supposed to split up, so you'd send a trio to here or a quintet to there, but you hardly played as a unit. And the reason you did that was because you were on call to be at each one of the classes. So class one, two, and three, we're all gonna be hearing music on this wonderful voyage. The next piece that we're gonna be doing is by Victor Herbert. Now Victor Herbert, hardly ever hear about him now, but he was the most popular American composer before World War I. And he wrote 40 operettas. He worked basically as a cocktail pianist to start off with. He worked in cafes. And in addition to that, he was a dynamite cellist. He was a classically trained musician. He wrote two operas. He wanted to be known as a serious composer, but he made so much money in the commercial world of operettas that he said, okay, we're doing that. And he went into the opera world, but with his money, he became quite wealthy. With his money, he gave a lot of it to new and up-and-coming composers and musicians. And in fact, he started what is still an ongoing organization called the Society of American Composers. And I may have gotten the name wrong, but it's still a, if you're a composer, you belong to that. And it helps publish your music, it gives you support, gives you financial support. It's still giving out grants today, and he's the person who started it. So here we go, two of his best pieces, March of the Toys from Babes in Toyland, and I'm Falling in Love. Okay. Thank you so much.